Yo, yo, peace was goody. It's not a song, my CD collection. It's part 83. I'm gonna call this episode the flea market edition, because I got these at the flea market last Saturday. But I just want to say there's a couple discrepancies when it comes to some of the CDs, and I'll explain why when I'm, you know, going through the CDs and stuff like that. But let me take a sip of my drink. Bacardi Lyman, baby. You already know. All right. First CD I want to show you guys is the Rhyme and the Reason soundtrack, released in 1997. Dope soundtrack and dope dope documentary, hip hop documentary. Very dope. If you guys haven't seen it, definitely check it out. I'm pretty sure it's on Netflix, but it's pretty dope. It has a nice mixture of West Coast and East Coast, and as well as like Midwest hip hop and down south hip hop. There's a couple of singles that came off this album. Nothing But the Cavi Hit, which features Mac 10 and Dog Pound, which is pretty dope. The Tragedy, featuring the RZA. Dope video for that too. What else? Is There a Heaven for a Gangster by Master P? That is my shit. That is one of Master P's dopest songs. That beat is just fucking bananas, man. Very, very dope. I know people don't really like Master P. I mean, he's not the best lyricist, but one thing about him, he makes rider music. That's one thing I like about his music. The beats, his ear for beats are fucking crazy. Especially like his 90s stuff, you know what I mean? But glad to own this joint right here. Been trying to get this album for a while. Well, not really. It wasn't like something that, you know, I was like trying to look for, but I was just glad to own this joint right here. But this is Rhyme and Reason soundtrack. Released in 1997, very dope, and definitely check out the documentary when you guys get a chance. Then we got Method Man's, this is his fourth album, 421, The Day After, released in 2006. You guys should know who Method Man is. I've mentioned Method Man before, you know. He put out dope, his first two albums, in my opinion, are classic material. You know what I'm saying? Method Man at one point was my favorite Wu member. But the thing with him is that he's not as consistent. You know what I mean? And I felt like his prime years was the 90s. After, like, you know, around 2001, he kind of, like, lost the flame. Because, you know, when he dropped the Tikal prequel album, it was kind of like, that album was kind of trash in my opinion. Maybe, like, two or three songs I like from the album, but other than that, I didn't really care for it. Even Method Man himself didn't care for that album. You know, he just said that, you know, he felt like, and he said himself, like, it had a lot to do with Diddy executive producing the album. So it's just some of the beats that, you know, was out of his control. You know what I mean? You know, he didn't really have creative control when it came to the album and stuff like that. And it definitely showed on that album. He went more commercial with that album and shit like that. But that's not the case with this album. This album, he kind of found himself again. It's a little bit of an improvement. It's not his best album, but it's not bad. And the thing with this album is that it never really got a lot of promotion either, because at that time, you know, Jay-Z, he became, I think he was like the vice president of Def Jam, or he was the president of Def Jam at that time. You know what I mean? But, you know, he didn't really get a lot of promotion on this album. I don't think there was any videos off this album or anything like that. I don't really know the singles. I think the only single off the album, I would say, is, let me see. There was a song he did with Lauryn Hill around this time, but I don't think it made the album. I think that's what it was, because he made a song with Lauryn Hill, but it never made the album. I want to say it was Say Something, but in number 13, Say, I think it would be Say, but I think that's someone with Lauryn Hill, but she's not credited. It's one of those two, but I believe that Lauryn Hill, she made a song with him around this time, but like I said, it never made the album, so it kind of sucks. But I don't even think this album has any singles as well. But Presidential MC, I fucking love that joint with Raekwon and RZA. I mean, it definitely has that Tikal Judgment Day feel to it, production-wise, and even, you know, the way Method Man was rapping at that time. Like, you know, he kind of brought it back around that time. But underrated album. It's not his best album, but like I said, it is somewhat of an improvement compared to Tikal prequel album. So yeah, this is Method Man 421, The Day After, released in 2006. Then we got my man Akrobatik out of Boston with his third album, Absolute Value, released in 2008. Yeah, I've mentioned him before. I showed you guys his first album, Balance, that came out in 2003. Yeah, this album has some decent stuff. It's not as good as his first album, Balance, which I have in my collection. This was alright. I feel like the production could have been a little bit better. But Akrobatik, you know, dope MC, very underrated. He's known for his affiliation with The Perceptionist. Yeah, he's known for his affiliation with Mr. Lift, you know what I mean? The whole Def Jux era, you know what I mean? Like, because, you know, they're both from Boston. Or, I believe Mr. Lift is from Cambridge, you know, where Harvard is at and shit like that. But that I consider like Boston, like the outskirts of Boston. I could be wrong about that. I know one of my subscribers will correct me on that. But yeah, this got some decent stuff. Like, I like the song Soul Glow. That's pretty cool. Put Your Stamp On It featuring Talib Kweli. That's pretty cool. I really like that joint. That's a pretty dope joint. But yeah, that's pretty much it, man. Akrobatik, Absolute Value, released in 2008. Second. Let's see what time I got left. Alright, still got some time. Alright. Next album. I was kind of glad to get this album, but again, this comes as where one of the discrepancies come with the album, and I'll explain why. And this album is True with True to the Game, released in 2000. This is their fourth album. This came out back in 1997. This is a double disc album. It's supposed to be a double disc album. you know what I mean? This is the reissue. This is not the original pressing. And how you can tell this is the reissue is that in the original pressing, which I'm pretty sure goes for a lot of money, there was a song, I believe that was on the first disc or the second disc, I don't remember. They took away a song called Smoking Green. I would like to hear that song. I haven't heard it yet. But I heard some songs of this. I heard some of the songs of this album. And I really like it, like the production. But here's what the discrepancy comes. Here's where the discrepancy comes. It's supposed to come with two discs. It only came with one. But again, I got it from the flea market. So, you know, for $5, you know, you can't beat that, you know. I was just so hyped to get this for $5, not knowing that, you know, it only came with one CD. If that was the case, I wouldn't have bought the CD, you know what I'm saying? But I was just so hyped to find this shit, because this song usually goes for a lot of money, especially the original pressing. I've seen the original pressing go for as much as like $50 online, so, but yeah, I've seen a decent copy for like, you know, I think like 12, 13 bucks on Amazon or whatever. It's a reissue, but I'll pick it up anyways because I like the album. I actually fucks with it. I would like to get their earlier stuff. I had the True album with the song I'm About It, which goes for a lot of money. That album I caught back in like 2001, so I know my dude Mike C has been trying to get that on for a while. So if I see a copy, my dude, I'll definitely pick up a copy for a decent price and I'll bless you with it, or we do like a trade or whatever. But yeah, True to the Game, this is released in 1997. Like I said, this is the reprint, the re-release version, the reissue, as I say. But yeah, No Limit, I mean, True, which stands for The Real Untouchables, which consists of Master P, Silk the Shocker, and C Murder. So, but yeah, dope shit right here. Get my sip of drink. Alright. I'm so glad I finally got my hands on this album. This is an album that I should have gotten years ago. But it's kinda hard to find in stores. But I'm kinda glad to get this album. But again, with this album that I'm about to show you guys, it's not as it's a little bit one of those discrepancies. All right, and it is Pete Rock's debut solo debut album, Soul Survivor, released in 1998. The discrepancy is this right here. It's supposed to be a jewel disc, where I don't know if you can see it. I don't know if you can see it very well, but there's like a picture of him right there. There's like a picture. It's supposed to be a picture. It's supposed to be clear, and there's like a picture and stuff like that. So that's like the only discrepancy. So if I see like another jewel case that I'm not really fucking with, then you know I'll just put it on here and stuff like that. But it's not really a big deal, but it is kind of a big deal for me. But you know I'm very anal when it comes to stuff like that. But overall, I'm just glad to own the album. The singles of the album are True Master, Respect the Deck, and Corrupt. It's a pretty dope video. You just see them like, you know, they're like a NASCAR drivers and stuff like that. I thought that was pretty cool. Let me see what else was a single as well. True Master, like, there's a video. There was a video for that. And I believe that was it. I think that's the only singles of that. I think that's the only single of the album. But this is a great album, and I'm kind of shocked that a lot of Pete Rock fans don't really mention this album, because they always mention the first two Pete Rock and CL Smooth albums, you know, The Main Ingredient and Megan and Soul Brother. But when it comes to this album, you know, people don't really mention it. I don't know why. I don't know if people felt like Pete Rock was trying to sell out or whatever, which I don't feel like it was the case. I feel like if anything, it was the opposite. Like he kept it real street. I mean, it was a nice versatile album, but it still had that street feel to it, and I really fucks with it. I mean, you got joints like Half Man, Half Amazing. Shout out to Grab Lover that did the beat for that. People think that Pete Rock did the beat, but actually Grab Lover did the beat. You know what I'm saying? Feature Method Man, that's a pretty dope joint right there. The Game, Raekwon, Prodigy, Ghostface. My favorite joint is Strange Fruit. Oh my fucking god. Fucking Sticky Fingers, he killed that joint. There's an unreleased version of that song. I think it's like the original version. It's with Tragedy, Pete Rock himself. I don't think Sticky Fingers was on the album. Noriega's on that version. Oh my god, that shit is fucking dope. I would have to do a review on this album eventually, but yeah, very dope. Glad to own this joint right here. It's kind of hard to find, at least where I'm at, but I'm glad to own this joint right here. It's Pete Rock Conceals, Pete Rock's debut album, Soul Survivor, released in 1998. Definitely one of the first producer albums, you know, in hip hop. And it's not the first, but because obviously Marley Marl did, you know, In Control back in 1988, and then In Control Volume 2, but definitely one of the earlier, you know, albums, as well as like Eric Sermon with the Insomnia compilation album that he dropped back in 1996. But yeah, very dope shit right here. Glad to own this joint right here. Very underrated. Then we got which I was kind of shocked to find. I'm pretty sure when I show you guys this, you're gonna be kind of shocked that I got this. But I was like, I definitely have to get this shit right here. But it is Redhead Kingpin and the FBI, released in 1989. Redhead Kingpin, MC from New York. He's known for his affiliation with Teddy Riley and the whole Rex and Effect crew. The production was done by him himself and as well as Markel Riley, who's Teddy Riley's brother, little brother. The singles off the album is Do the Right Thing, Pump It Up, Hottie, and We Rock the Mic. We Rock the Mic Right. Those are the singles of the album. This album right here, it kind of has like that New Jack Swing kind of feel to it. So kind of in the vein of like Father MC and that kind of thing. If you're not into that kind of stuff, then you definitely wouldn't like this album. It definitely got some decent joints. It's not his best shit, but 4 years later, he dropped the album under a different name, and he was still called the Redhead Kingpin. But he actually had a group. He reinvented himself, and he had a group called the Private Investigators, which I believe is called React Like You Know. I think it's called is the name of the album, which I'm trying to get my hands on. It's a little bit hard to. It's out of print. It's hard to find. The album's a lot more rugged. You know what I mean? It's funny because back then, back in the early 90s, like around 93, 94, 95. That tend to be a trend, because there's a couple of groups and artists, when they first come out, they kind of have like that squeaky clean kind of image, and then their second album they just go all gangster and shit like that. I.e. what's a good album I could bring up? These are the New School Time, the Inner Mind's Eye album. If you listen to their first song, A Feature Without a Past, they were kind of like squeaky clean, that kind of thing, kind of innocent. Their second album, they just went all gangster. Another group, UMC's, with Kool Kim, they dropped that album, Fruits of Nature, back in 1991. Very dope album. Their second album, Unleashed, that came out, I believe, in 93 and 94, they went all gangster. What else? What's another good album? But you guys get what I'm trying to say. There's like a trend going on, but there's a couple of artists that actually did that. But you guys get what I'm trying to say. With this album, Redhead King himself, he said in an interview that he didn't really care for this album. He didn't really like what he was doing. But again, he was just kind of going through some like personal demons at the time. But he just put it out just to put it out. But he felt more at peace when he dropped the second album, the Private Investigators album. So, but yeah, I'm glad to own this joint right here. Got some decent stuff. Not his best, not the best material, but just glad to own it in the collection. See how much I got left. Still got some time. Then we got Big Noyd with Illustrious, released in 2008. Glad to own this joint right here. Big Noyd, his albums are kind of getting hard to come by. They're kind of hard to find right now nowadays, especially in stores. But again, for $5, you can't go wrong with that. Very good album right here. You know, it's a little bit different. And the reason why I say it's different is because this is the first album that it's the first album that he's done without any Mobb Deep affiliates. Like, and so what I'm trying to say is like, there's no like, you know, hip up like Mobb Deep affiliates as far as like MCs or producers. You know, you got people like, cause usually on this album, you know, you would have, you know, people like you know, Infamous Mobb, Prodigy, or Hav, or anything like that. This was the first album that you didn't really get that with this album. You know what I mean? So you kind of like branched out, and it was a little bit different. Fizzy Womack, aka Little Fame of MOP, did some of the production. Actually, you know, the single of this album is actually Things Don't Change featuring Kira. There was a video for that shit right there. Pretty dope joint right there. A lot of people kind of criticize this album because, you know, a lot of people say that, oh, he was trying to go commercial and things like that. I don't think that was the case, but, you know, I like this album. Like I said, it's not his best, but it's not bad either. I'll tell you one thing, it's a lot better than his third album that he dropped on the Grind that came out in 2004. Oh my god, that was horrendous. With the album cover where he's like in front of like a newspaper, kind of looks like the New York Post. That was a horrendous album, but I have to get that album. I could get it for dirt cheap online, but just to add on to the collection and stuff like that. But Big Noyd, definitely one of my favorite MCs out of Queens or Queensbridge. Very underrated. His flow is fucking crazy, and people don't really give him props for that. But I would love to hear another album from him. Matter of fact, I just watched the interview like a couple of days ago. I think like 2 days ago, actually, where he said he's gonna drop a new album with Havoc doing all the beats and stuff like that. Can't wait for that. So it's gonna be like episodes of Hustler all over again, but 2016. So I would love to hear. I just can't wait for that. But yeah. Would love to hear another Big Noyd album. It's long overdue, man. But Big Noyd, Illustrious, released in 2008. Alright. Now, another album I'm glad to own, or I'm glad I copped. But again, when it comes to discrepancies, it's one of those too. And it is Master Killa's No Set Date. Released in 2004, this is his debut album. This came out 2004, like I said before. Dope album, definitely one of his best albums. But I feel like it was an album that I feel like it came out a little bit too late. I wish it dropped back in the 90s and stuff like that. You know what I mean? I feel like it came out too late, but like I said, better late than never. I don't. I don't even think this time I have any singles that I know of. But I know the song. Oh, what's that song? School was a big song out back then. Grab the Mic, that's my shit right there. Secret Rivals, that's a dope joint right there. Last Drink, that's a pretty dope joint right there, pretty dope. A lot better than, you know, the Made in Brooklyn album that came out back in 2006, which is the second album which I have in my collection. That one was okay, but it was just like all over the place in my opinion. Not that it was all over the place, but I just felt like the production didn't really grab me like that, and that wasn't the case with this album. Now, the discrepancy of this album, it was come out with a DVD. They didn't come with a DVD, you know what I mean? So, but again, I got it at the flea market. It was $5, so I was like, fuck it, let me just pick it up. But I know it's like dirt cheap online, so definitely have to pick it up, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, No Set Date by Masta Killa, released in 2004. Pick it up if you can find it. It's out of print, so. Last two albums. Finally got my hands on this album. I got it for a pretty decent price. $5. Can't beat it. And it is Raekwon's album, Only But for Cuban Links Part 2, released in 2009. This album should have came out years ago. It was supposed to come out back in 2006, but he kept pushing it back and stuff like that. He finally came out in 2009. There's a couple of singles off the album. The singles are House of a Flying Daggers, Pyrex Vision, which is a video for that. Love that song. Too fucking short, if you ask me. New Woo, that was a single. I believe Surgical Gloves was a single too. There was a video for that. Ason Jones was dope. Catalina. And I believe that was it. I think those are the singles off the album. Decent album. Not my favorite from him. I know I'm going to get a lot of shit for that. But I'll have to explain why. You know what I mean? But I'm not going to get into that. But I feel like the album could have been a little bit better. But that's just my opinion. But this is Raekwon, The Only Girl for Cuban Links Part 2. Released in 2009. Last but not least, glad to find this album in this edition. And it is Lloyd Banks' debut album, titled Hunger for More, released in 2004. Again, one of the albums that has discrepancies, and I'll explain why. This album came out in 2004. Lloyd Banks, he was like one of the hottest sensations when it came to, especially in New York, you know, especially around like the mixtape circuit era. Back when mixtapes meant something at that time, like, sometimes mixtapes were better than the albums coming out, and that was the case with this album. Good album, not his best stuff, in my opinion. I kind of feel like The Big Withdrawal, that album that was supposed to come out back in 2005, but it got leaked because he had a threesome, and one of the girls leaked it out, and then you get this is an album that you can get, you know, online and stuff like that for free and shit like that. It's actually on Dat Piff, and then he ended up redoing new material, and that ended up becoming Rotten Apple and stuff like that. But this album, I mean, got a couple singles. The singles are On Fire, I'm So Fly, and Karma. Those are the three singles off the album. But that's like the more commercial kind of sounds and stuff like that. But you know, you got dope joints like Ain't No Click, fucking love that joint. Playboy, Warrior, I'm a motherfucking warrior. That's my shit right there. I didn't like the remix though. The remix sucked. I'm sorry. Eminem did the remix to that. I wasn't really digging that. Warrior was like more rugged, more street and shit like that. I mean, the punchlines on that album, fucking dope. Yeah, Warrior Part 2 featuring Eminem, 50 Cent, Nate Dogg. I mean, I just wasn't really digging that joint right there. I prefer the original, but that's just my opinion. When the Chips Are Down, fucking dope shit right there. South Side Story, fucking dope. This version comes with the DVD, but again, it ain't came with the DVD, so, you know, I only have the CD, so, you know, it is what it is, but it comes with the bonus track called Just Another Day, so I thought that was pretty cool. So I'm gonna try to look for this version again and get the official version and stuff like that. But I'm glad to own this one right here, and that's pretty much it. Hope you guys enjoyed that video. Stay tuned for more videos from me. Peace.